From Interior Alaska's most trusted news source, this is the Fairbanks Evening News.
Good evening and thanks for joining us. Our top story tonight, a North Pole man turned himself in last evening after allegedly shooting and killing another male. 41-year-old Matthew Davis of North Pole is currently in custody, charged with the first-degree murder of 34-year-old John Adam Chilcote of North Pole. According to a release, Davis, seen here, broke into a residence, ran upstairs and shot Chilcote several times. Troopers received a call reporting a home invasion. The caller was hiding when Chilcote was shot. Davis then left the residence in his vehicle and later showed up at North Pole Police Department to turn himself in. Davis is due to be arraigned in Fairbanks District Court tomorrow.
The complainant did tell Alaska State Troopers that they were still in the residence and one person had been shot. Troopers, as well as North Pole Police Department, immediately responded over there and they did find a male. This is an ongoing investigation and we don't usually provide a lot of too much information up front because with ongoing investigation, you sometimes find new information. And so we really need to focus on what we can find out on scene and through our interviews to determine what exactly transpired.
A Fairbanks man who was jailed for a probation violation has been ordered to serve more time. Trevante Osby pleaded guilty to a single count of reckless driving. The state agreed to drop his other felony, and as part of a plea deal, he will serve another 18 months in jail. Osby was accused of driving recklessly and crashing into a fence. He then fled on foot, and troopers reportedly found him hiding under a cabin in North Pole. Osby previously served 3 of his 8-year sentence in the negligent homicide of a 19-month-old toddler, placed on probation for a period of 10 years as well. As the state of Alaska struggles to deal with less revenue because of oil prices, some analysts are predicting the price of oil could go even lower. Prices have been dropping steadily since the peak of $115 in June, losing nearly 50%. Patrick DeHaan of GasBuddy.com said oil prices have been very bipolar during the past 2 weeks. In the past 24 hours, there has been a $5 difference in the high and low price of a barrel of oil due to market volatility. DeHaan says it's still anybody's guess whether oil could actually drop to $20 a barrel, as some are predicting.
With oil prices having fallen from $100 down to $43, a $60 barrel decline, another drop of, say, $25 a barrel is not that extreme. I think it remains unlikely. There are a lot of moving pieces right now. Some of them include the Middle East, the Saudis, what the Saudis are saying. So one thing I can tell you is that oil prices aren't likely to shoot back to previous highs, but probably won't get to record lows.
It was just last week that a number of nonprofits were looking at major budget cuts. But after further evaluation, those cuts have been rescinded. Thanks to the efforts of a coalition made up of the Salvation Army, the Fairbanks Rescue Mission, the Interior Center for Nonviolent Living, and the Fairbanks Housing and Homeless Coalition, of course, along with massive media promotion, the once lost funds look like they will be reinstated, along with an additional $1 million. One agency told us that these funds will prevent a major crisis.
Praise the Lord. We're extremely excited that the governor and all those involved have decided to go ahead and put the funding for the BHAP grant and the SNAP grant back in the Alaska budget for this coming year. It's a very important program. It's a preventative program designed to help people out of the situation they're in, get them back on their feet so they can become important, productive figures in the community. And so it's a really important decision, and we're extremely grateful.
Governor Bill Walker today announced the appointment of 3 new members to the Alaska Gas Line Development Corporation, including former State Senator Joe Pascvan of Fairbanks. Pascvan joins Rick Halford of Dillingham and Hugh Short of Anchorage as appointees to the board, which oversees efforts to develop liquefied natural gas in Alaska. They replaced 3 previous members who were dismissed by Walker in the name of transparency in negotiating a potential natural gas pipeline. Walker says these latest appointees fit the mold he envisions for board members.
I like a group of Alaskans that their expertise is, you know, a lot of time in Alaska, a lot of time paying for high cost of energy, knowing the importance of how critical this project is. So that makes good board members to me. Our expertise is not going to be board driven. Our expertise is going to be, you know, is going to be administration driven by the administration of AGDC. So.
When we come back, the Go Red campaign continued today with a red tie breakfast for the men at the Carlson Center. Also, it's Thursday night, which means it's time once again for our Fairbanks flavor, one of our favorites. Tonight, we spotlight pesto. These stories plus more when we return. Welcome back. Last weekend, red hearts were everywhere celebrating Valentine's Day. Today at the Carlson Center, there were more red hearts, only this time the occasion was recognizing the Go Red campaign nationwide. The 2015 Men's Red Tie Breakfast featured a number of speakers, including local doctors educating the overflow gathering about proper nutrition, exercise, and the debilitating, sometimes fatal effects of heart disease. The program also featured Allie Vincent, a former winner of the Biggest Loser TV show, and the process she went through to lose 112 pounds over a six-month period. But the main purpose of the breakfast was to explain the ramifications of poor health and its relationship to heart disease.
Well, the Go Red for Women is really bringing awareness to women's health. But we really like to incorporate the men because it affects men as well, but also they have wives and daughters and mothers, and it's really important to make sure that they're aware of health, heart disease and what comes from that.
And this is really an event that's focused on heart health, specifically towards men. It's a fundraiser for the American Heart Association, and it is really a good kickoff to the Go Red, which, as you know, is a national movement throughout the United States that is increasing the heart healthy awareness of heart disease and stroke.
The ladies will have their Go Red luncheon tomorrow at noon at the Carlson Center. All right, well, cross-country running is a sport well known in Alaska's interior. A movie set to be released tomorrow takes a look at the sport, one that is rarely glamorized and even less known about in other parts of the country. The new movie McFarland USA is based on the true story of a high school cross-country team and their coach, played by Kevin Costner. The team was made up of Mexican-American boys who had little experience in competitive running. The film was produced by Gordon Gray, who has strong ties to the interior. His mother, Jenny Gray, who calls herself the producer of the producer, is a longtime Fairbanks resident. Her son has produced other notable films, including Miracle, Secretariat, and Invincible. Jenny says Gordon has not shared many details on his latest film, though he did send her a suit similar to the one worn by Costner in the movie.
He's been rather quiet. I must admit, I was in California in January. He says, Mom, you're just going to have to go see it. And he left it at that. And I've been hanging ever since. I hope the local folks come see this movie. It's inspirational, as all his movies are. They're clean. Disney prides themselves on keeping it clean because inspirational movies for our young folks are very important.
That is awesome. All right, now it's time for this week's edition of Fairbanks Flavor with Lisa Gambardella.
Buonasera, welcome to Gambardella's Pasta Bella. I'm Lisa Gambardella, and this is Fairbanks Flavor. Today we're making a delicious, creamy pesto. It's fun to make. It can be light or heavy as you want with whatever richness you want to put in there. But definitely, you want to toast the garlic first. So have a hot pan and let that nutty flavor come out. I used extra virgin olive oil. I'm going to add some pre-made pesto, which is basil and cheese and oil. We're going to spike up the flavor later to make it go really well with the Sauvignon Blanc or a Chenin Blanc. Really good. And I've got a little secret weapon I don't normally use. If that looks good. I can really smell the flavors developing. That garlic is really getting nutty. Woo! Nutty, delicious. I'm going to put my fettuccine in there. There we go. Wow, that looks delicious already. Oh my goodness. Little butter, little pesto. Okay, here's my secret thing I like to do after that is add in some fresh basil, some cilantro. There's my secret weapon for the Chenin Blanc or Sauvignon Blanc. Really makes it pop. Put some fresh Romano on there, lots of it, and some freshly grated pepper. You're gonna love this. Make it at home or we'll make it for you. Buenos Aires, see your recipes at webcenter11.com.
Brought to you by Gambardella's Pasta Bella.
I'm starving now. All right, Joe Cook is up next with sports. He has a preview of this weekend's Ice Dog Series plus high school hoops action from Wednesday. Stay with us.
Welcome back, Interior Sports fans. Joe Cook back again this Thursday evening with your local sports. The Fairbanks Ice Dogs return to the Big Dipper this weekend. The Ice Dogs will be the featured team the final weekend of Hockey Week in Fairbanks. The Dogs will be playing someone other than Kenai. They host the Keystone Ice Miners, a second-place team in the North Division. They're on a four-game skid. They have a solid goalie duo in Nick Kozoff and Alex Blankenberg. Both are top 12 in the NHL, saving 92% of their shots. They both have at least 11 wins. So Fairbanks will be looking to generate a lot of shots to test these goalies. They come in, the Ice Dogs, with a 32-13-3 record and a five-game win streak. That win streak has to increase this weekend. They want to accomplish their ultimate goals.
Yeah, we got the standings on the board in there, and we're just kind of trying to catch up to the Wilderness. So it's our number one goal right now, but we just got to take it game by game.
Well, their goaltending is really good. It's one of the best goaltending tandems in the league. We feel we have one of the best as well. Last time we were down there, we put up a lot of shots, and we didn't get rewarded much for the shots that we put on net. So we've got to find ways to create second chance opportunities for ourselves.
Wednesday night was the fourth meeting between the West Valley Wolfpack and the Lathrop Malamutes on the hard court. The Wolfpack honored their seniors on senior night, and one senior made a huge contribution. Charles Southern scored 12 points and helped Lathrop's leading scorer, Jaden Whiteside, to 2 points. And as Jaden was returning after missing a couple games for Lathrop, this game was tight as usual. The Wolfpack got Daniel Hornbuckle back just a week after a bruised Achilles injury. He scored a game-high 14 points, including a huge jumper to break a 42 tie with 40 seconds left. The Pack would win 46-42 for their first win over Lathrop this season.
I feel good. It's nice to be back out there with the team. Like, all that adrenaline flowing and then teammates pumping you up and then the crowd going. It's nice to get that win finally, but we know that we got to do it again in regionals if we want to go to state. So we just got to make sure we stay humble and then make sure we can do what we need to do, take care of business.
Well, it's not another game. It's a rivalry game, but we're supposed to do that. So, you know, it's nice, but on senior night, you know, to finally beat them, but we're supposed to do it.
And in the girls' game, West Valley and Lathrop met for another tight rivalry game. This time, the Doe girls, they were available back from out of town, and they made their presence felt with a few buckets in the early going. Neither team could pull away. It was tight 33-33 after three quarters. Jana Hadukovic, she led the Mutes with 16 points, but the Wolfpack gained control with a stifling fourth quarter, outscoring Lathrop 24-8. Ruthie Hebert had a game high, 19 points and 19 rebounds. The Pack win 57-41 on senior night as lone senior Carlin Marquez was honored. They are now 19-0. In the Aurora Conference, the Hutchinson Hawks hosted the Monroe Rams in the girls' game. Andy Clark scored 3 of her 6 points here, and it was just a 26-20 game in favor of Hutch in the third quarter, but the Hawks would go on a huge run, 23-2, and they outscored the Rams 32-10 in the second half. They go on for the 58-27 win. Ashley Stark, she had 8 for Hutch, while Ellie Veazey scored a game-high 16 points. The Hawks are 15-5 overall and 5-2 in the Aurora. In the boys' game, Hutchinson found a way to be close early. Mike Benson, he led the Hawks for 15 points, but Emmanuel Pacheco, he hit back-to-back three-pointers, including one the first quarter horn. The Hawks were down 17-18. Then Monroe, they just responded with a 14-0 run, which featured Mike Cluding, who had 16. Edwin Erickson scored 12. Jeremiah Bailey, he had 10. And Jalen McCullough scored a game-high 19 points. Monroe wins 74-50. They are 14-3 and 6-0 in the Aurora. In other games on Wednesday, the North Pole Patriots boys ended their six-game losing streak with a 61-49 win over the Allison Ravens on senior night. Senior Shane Hurst of North Pole had a monster 26.15 rebound performance to lead all scorers. A little bit of history was made last night at Birch Hill in the Wednesday night race ski series. 24 skiers came out to a warm Birch Hill to ski the 2.4K course. They went around twice. Mike Kramer, he had an early advantage, but then Christina Terman made her move in the second lap and pulled away from Kramer in the field. She finished in 12 minutes, 51 seconds and was the overall winner. Now, apparently, Terman is the first woman to be the overall winner in the WNR. And if that name sounds familiar, she's the interim head coach of the UAF ski team. Kramer was second, and he was the men's winner in 13 minutes, 14 seconds. Selene Frost was third, followed by Peter Delamere and Melissa Lewis to round out the top five. The humble Terman scurried away before our cameras could get to her after her win. But Kramer, he was impressed.
I didn't know what to expect. I didn't really actually plan on doing it, but I was here and saw the excitement building, so I jumped in. And Christina Terman was very strong. She tracked me on that first lap and then bolted up that hill, and I had no answer. She was gone, but it was fun.
And that'll do it for sports tonight. Mike Schultz is next with your full weather forecast, and we'll catch you next time.
And welcome back to our broadcast. It's time now to take a look at the weather because Mike Schultz is out. I will be filling in, so let's start by looking with our picture today. All right, this picture was sent in by Nancy Hummel. Another great sunset. And I don't know about you guys, but I have certainly been enjoying these beautiful sunsets and sunrises early in the morning, filling that vitamin D. All right, and let's take a look at current conditions up on your screen. 19 degrees, high today 21 degrees, that's pretty good. Low 12 degrees, record high, look at that, 42 degrees back in 2006, so not that long ago, but wow, record low, 50 below in 1956. I think I'm not alone when I say I'm glad we are well above that. Sunrise today, 8:33 a.m., sunset at 5:39 p.m., giving us 9 hours and 6 minutes. That's a gain of 7 minutes from yesterday. All right, let's take a quick look at the Alaska satellite. As you can see, not much going on over here in the interior, but over on the western side of our state, there is some action, but nothing to worry about. No snow in the near future. All right, let's take a look at what was going on today. 18 degrees in Fairbanks, that's pretty darn good. Barrow, 12 degrees. It doesn't look like there's any precipitation in our state except for over the Anchorage Bowl, a little bit in Anchorage, 31 degrees. Taking a look over at the southeast, their temperatures, wow, 40 degrees in Juneau, 41 in Ketchikan with sun. That looks amazing. Cold Bay, cloudy skies, 42 degrees. Bethel, 35 degrees. I mean, it's just pretty warm overall over our state. All right, let's dive on down to the lower 48 because unfortunately that cannot be said about my friends over in New York. Let's start over there on the East Coast, New York. They are experiencing some record low temperatures. I had family members message me saying that it was 20 below and that's a cold, cold time over there. Okay, but scoot down to Miami, it looks like 60 degrees over there. Rain over New Orleans, 49 degrees. And to Seattle, rain, 52 degrees. And look at the snow in Minneapolis, 9 degrees there. All right, let's take a quick look at the satellite radar. As you can see, like I said, that system is just hanging there over the northeast sections of the country, the lower 48. They are just getting pounded with snow, feet upon feet of snow. I had seen pictures today that Niagara Falls actually froze. That's pretty crazy. All right, and let's look at, yeah, the temperatures there. 4 degrees in New York, New York, Detroit, 10 below, Pittsburgh, 7 below, Cincinnati, 10 below. I mean, it's record chilling there. So, wow, we can't say that about here, though. Back to Alaska for tomorrow. Northern section, scattered snow showers for Barrow, snow showers with freezing drizzle for Nome, so be careful if you're there driving. Mostly cloudy skies for Fort Yukon, and the temperatures look like they're in the high teens to low 20s. All right, let's scoot back to the interior. Mostly cloudy in the morning, then partly cloudy in the afternoon across the region. 24 degrees, I mean, that's not bad. A little bit breezy in Healy, but nothing much. And temperatures look like they're in the mid to upper 20s across the interior. All right, let's take a look at the southeast. Scattered clouds from Juneau to Ketchikan. Temperatures in the 40s, 45 degrees in Ketchikan, 42 in Juneau. And okay, scoot on over to the southwest. Wind and rain for Cold Bay, partly cloudy for Kodiak. Slight chance of snow for Bethel, but not too much. 32 degrees there. All right, and let's end it with Anchorage. The Anchorage Bowl, mostly sunny for Anchorage, becoming partly cloudy in Valdez and Homer. Temperatures there are still pretty consistent along with the rest of the state. 30s, upper 30s for Homer. All right, and let's move on over to our kids' weather watch. And in 1988, this is a cool little weather fact for us. Valdosta, Georgia. One-day record was set when more than 7 inches of rain falls. That's not that impressive, but that's okay because guess what? Next week, the kids from Weller will be back giving us some facts and asking Mike some questions, so that'll be great. All right, tonight, 3 degrees above zero for our low, partly cloudy skies with a little bit colder, but watch for the auroras because just like the other night, they may be out and beautiful as always. For tomorrow, 27 degrees, another day like today, and it tends to be looking a little bit warmer. And let's look at our extended outlook for the rest of the week. Just look at that. Just take it in for 1 second. 37 degrees on Saturday. Get out there and enjoy it. 35 and 30 on Monday with possibility of snow, which is good because that means we can still ski, we can still hit the slopes, snow machine, whatever you want to do. Lows look like the lowest temperature is 17 below. So you know what? I will take that. All right, that'll wrap up this edition of the Fairbanks Evening News. As always, we're glad you can join us tonight on NBC Nightly News. Another superbug outbreak is raising concerns about hospital cleanliness. Tune in, that's next with Lester Holt. And remember, you can join us here 6 days a week, 6 and 11, or online anytime at webcenter11.com, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube. We are everywhere. From all of us here at the News Center, we hope you have a great night.